and so many parts of the community in Bolton to this evening, or a celebration of sport and all that sport can achieve within a community. This is the annual Tillotson Lecture, but our topic this evening is the inspiration of Sir Philip Craven, an old boy of the school who visited us during the last year and suggested, or as Sir Philip often does, insisted that the Tillotson Lecture this year should be about the Olympic legacy in the North West. And we were delighted when he accepted that invitation, and when he was able to invite Lord Cole to join us this evening, and we're delighted that you can join the panel for the discussion and say a few words. Sir Philip also was very keen that the current emerging athletes joined us this evening to take their view on the legacy, and it's a huge pleasure to invite have invited Sophie Hancock to join the panel. As you've seen in your programme, Sophie achieved gold in the shot put at the Paralympics World Cup in 2009 and has her sights firmly set on London 2012. To my right, Danny Strunsky is the current holder of the 100-metre breaststroke record, an old boy of Bolton School, and also training and preparing himself for the 2012 Games. That is our panel this evening. We're going to begin the Tillotson Lecture by hearing presentations first from Sir Philip and then from Lord Carl. Sir Philip.
Well, thanks, Master, and I've not got on that stage yet, because I'm a small boy and a bigger boy, maybe, and all the, you know, you probably all know, really, you're all sat the wrong way. I've still not got on there, if you're erecting this stage on the side, so there you go. And really, I'm not only here tonight because this is my old school. In fact, that isn't the main reason. The main reason is that it's because of the school's and Bolton's commitment to the benefits of practicing sport and physical activity. Because we're in a school for young people, but I believe it's for everyone. And as I said, I had this, what I thought was a great visit to the school earlier in the year. And I was inspired by the school and Bolton's commitment. But also I was concerned at that time, and I still am, about the way maybe governments, or because of cooks, or etc., perceive the importance of sport at schools. And I think it's something that should be absolutely paramount, and I think that tonight is an opportunity to really send a message out that what's happening in the school, or what's happening in Bolton, is crucial for the future of our young people. But, and so tonight, really, in the 10 minutes I've got, I just want to speak about the benefits of sport for all people, and in particular, surprisingly or not, future Paralympians. And really, Seb over here, who, he's a great friend of mine now, and a bit of a nutcase like me, but that's great, and he's over in the Northwest, and I mean, he's brought up in South Yorkshire, but no one's perfect, and I know that Seb really, as chairman of Volcock, the expert on the Olympic and Paralympic Games in London, and in the UK, of course, next year, and so I know that Seb for the cover, primarily, or the Games. So, I just want to tell you a little bit about myself when I was at this school, and I love three sports, really. One was cricket, the other tennis, and the other swimming. And I was reasonably talented at them all, and then maybe because I also had a bit of a big head, I didn't really enjoy, I didn't feel that I needed to train much. So I never made any of the school teams. But the sport that I really enjoyed playing was football. I was never any good at it. And I think that what that taught me early on in my career was that if you've got great hand-eye coordination, it doesn't mean you've got great foot-eye coordination. I wanted to play, I played all the time in the school yard, always home late from school, but still never got any good. And I think that the one thing that I've learned since I was 40, going back to that time, and I think this is important for schools, is that you don't always love sport because of the way your body's made up. In other words, 6'6", you've got to be a basketball player or a volleyball player. Or, dependent on how how much natural talent you've got for a sport. There could be something deep inside you that loves the sport. It doesn't mean that necessarily you're going to be good. But after my accident when I was 16, I had a rock climbing accident in Wilton Quarries just up the road from here. Wheelchair basketball was the real deal for me. It was the sport where I did enjoy the training as much as the playing. I mean, it had everything. It had skills, it had physicality, it had tactical. I've got all the tactics that I'm not sure I want to pick those up, but I really love playing the sport. And I loved it, I got pretty good at it, and that lasted for about 25 years. But tonight's not about me, even though this school will certainly has provided a flexible environment in which I could start my development as a human being. But it's about the students, it's about the teachers, it's about the town councillors, it's about the parents, and it really is about why sport is so important for everyone. And so, really, practicing sport and getting better at sport means you have to acquire basic skills. But there's far more to it than that, and you don't realise it when you're doing it, but it's not just about shooting, passing, dribbling the ball, while also moving the chair at great speed. But over the years, you pick up subconsciously life skills that are priceless as you go forward and you get older. And you cannot acquire them despite being in a school where learning some of the time comes out of a book. You cannot acquire those skills from a book, off the internet, a TV, speaking on a mobile, or even tweeting. So, why sports are great? Well, I think, first of all, sports has got to be fun. You have to enjoy it. And that might not be the case with my recollection of every subject on the school curriculum that maybe you're forced to follow. But sport has to be fun. And practicing sport and getting better as it raises self-esteem makes you feel good. And you develop lifelong friendships, and you get a tendency through these friendships, to want to find new friends as you go out there in the world. You play within the rules, even though at times you test the rules. And really, that's the antithesis of war. You know, there's a lot of about peace and sport now, and there's a couple of major organisations in the world. But you learn to play fairly, hopefully with honesty, and you generate trust amongst your teammates, and even amongst your opponents. And teamwork, even in individual sports, you've got a great athlete here off to my left, a great potential swimmer here off to my left, everyone is off to my left, a great shot putter. But you've got to develop even a team environment with your coach. And so teamwork's absolutely fundamental. Learning to harness aggression and frustration, that's what sport helps you do. And I can tell you, I had a certain aggressive streak when I was at school, but I'm not going to tell you about that, at least not from here tonight. And I was really quite ruthless as a wheelchair basketball player in my early 20s. And I believed at that time that everybody had to train as hard as I did. I went to Manchester University, scraped through the lower second in geography, and definitely got a first class honours in wheelchair basketball. But I trained 4 hours a day, and I expected everybody to train as hard as me. But that's not how teams are made up. Teams are made up from different individuals. Probably the more talent you have, the less training you need. And that's what I found out. Maybe I didn't have a lot of talent, but I did a lot of training I got through. A bit like Jeff Boycott, you know, in cricket. I know a lot about it. Toby, don't mention Chelsea, but I can get at him from his Yorkshire group saying. And learning to give rather than always take, and that's another thing you have to learn about in sport. Got a gift to the team. And the final thing, well, this is the finite list, is to learn to communicate face to face with people. I've just put down here defence or offence in wheelchair basketball. But you don't acquire that, again, from talking or texting on mobiles. So all these benefits apply to Olympians and Paralympians, and I'm not going to say too much more now, it's obviously taking a little bit longer to say this than I intended, but there's some things that are even more important for potential Paralympians. And Paralympic sport, and nowhere more than next year in London, really overturns outdated perceptions on the inabilities of persons with a perceived disability. It overturns negative attitudes coming from myths and fears that have been passed down from generation to generation. And these misconceptions are based on ignorance and negative attitudes, and they've led to the collective marginalisation persons with a perceived disability. And the creation, and this we saw a lot in China, we turned it around 3 years ago, of a care syndrome of a minority by the majority. So in the past there's been little opportunity for the individual to shine through. But really I'd just like to list a few of the extra or deeper benefits that sport can bring to persons with a perceived disability. This raising self-esteem, promoting self-determination, promoting individualism, and then promoting freedom rather than collective marginalisation. And getting to know your body, you know? Most of you think, oh my God, it's terrible if I lost an arm or a leg. You're right, it would be. It'd be painful, it wouldn't be very nice. But once you end up in that situation, you've got to get on with it. And you've got to get on with maximising the use of what's left. I'm not really worrying too much about what doesn't work, because there's loads that does. And that's what Donna Ritchie said, the captain of the Australian women's wheelchair basketball team in 2000. She said you have to get to know what works and maximise the use of it, not worry too much about what doesn't work. And so adding to this comprehension of your own body, admiration for it, the individual becomes healthy and starts to feel good about themselves. And just again about the team, and I'm just going to give you a quote here from Chris Scott. He won 2 Paralympic gold medals in cycling in Athens. But he said, by becoming part of the Paralympics, my self-confidence and self-esteem have greatly increased. But to be named male team captain in Athens was the pinnacle of my career, more important than his medals. So, my conclusions would be that I'd like to bring together just these conclusions. The Paralympians do not accept the limitations that may be placed on them by others. They challenge preconceived notions held by parts of society and they act as catalysts for social change. And performances at the Paralympic Games exhibit abilities of individuals, all of whom are talented members of society. If you just look at wheelchair marathon, the world record in wire 20 minutes, you know, my best time was 3 hours 59, in my basketball chair, though. But 1 hour 20 minutes for wheelchair marathon. Oscar Pistorius, 45.07 seconds. With 2 prostheses. The world high jump record for a leg amputee, 2.11 meters. So finally, coming back to teamwork, and you can see I'm a passionate believer in what sport can do for people. I just want to talk for about 30 seconds about the guy who's 4 up from me under the left set call. And really about what a pleasure it is for you on the board at Low Carb. Really I shouldn't be there, because I'm the president of the International in on this board and saying, what are you doing? Are you doing it well? And if you're not, well, you better do it this way. Well, because I'm an IOC member, I found myself to be on the board. So I actually thought, oh my God, I better be a little bit careful because I criticise the board, I criticise myself. But I just want to tell you that it's been a fabulous experience for 6 years. And this guy here, he's the head of the team now, which he's got, he'll probably tell you, is he nearly 2,000 employees now? Hearing that. But it started off with just a few people. And the key for Seb as the chairman, obviously the budget, and we hear about, you know, costs and budgets, we reckon nothing else, you know, let's worry about the conference down the road and all this. But that's very important. But we need a chairman who can keep the balance there between the budget and sport. And that's what he does. He does a great job. And I'm just super proud to be part of the board and to be part of what are going to be fabulous games. So I don't know if it must be fine handing over to Seb or whether you are. Well, that's the end of what I've